Thank you very much for having me here and for coming to learn about the crows. I live close by, and I commute on the 372 every day from the Bothell Park and Ride, so I feel your pain. I enjoy it, though. It's fantastic to me to see all these birds coming in to roost here. And I thought what I'd do before I have this talk, which is kind of a general discussion of lots of weird things that people have told us about crows, some of which you may have seen. But I thought I'd just start right off with the roosting behavior that you guys are experiencing here. And again, I can answer more questions about that when we're done. But basically, the birds that are roosting here, for one thing, they're coming from all over the Snohomish Valley out to, I think, probably even birds that are out to Gold Bar and Salton in that area. They are also coming from downtown Seattle and all around, Mill Creek. I'm not sure about Everett, if there are birds from that far away that are coming in or not. But there are several thousand birds, probably 10,000, that are roosting here. And there are many other roosts around the area, and the birds move around between those roosts. So we know that most of the birds that are here, just a few years ago, were roosting behind the Kenmore Park and Ride in the Heron Colony area there. And before that, they were mostly roosting by the UW-Seattle in the Arboretum area on Foster Island. There's also roosts over in Totem Lake and Bellevue. There was one on the Snohomish River. And for some reason, now those birds are mainly focused on this particular site. So I don't really know why they shifted, except maybe it has something to do with the vegetation in the planted restoration area being now at the right size and structure for the birds to really utilize. And that wasn't the case a few years ago. So it may just be a coincidence of circumstances that they are now so intense in this particular area. But all their roosts share a lot of the same qualities. They minimize commuting distances between where they're feeding. So this is kind of central between those locations I just mentioned. They like to be in large numbers for safety. They can scold and mob and chase out predators from an area in large numbers. But they do suffer the costs of being very conspicuous. I was telling Lisa I was coming out of the park and ride about 3 weeks ago now in the Bothell Park and Ride, and right as I was pulling out, I hear this whack, and it was a red-tailed hawk taking a crow out of the air, which I'd never seen, right in front of me as the birds were coming to roost, took it down to the ground and ate it. So being conspicuous also has its costs. They're conspicuous to predators as well. So they do perhaps are able to move some predators away by being in large numbers. And of course, you minimize your individual chance of being eaten if you're in a group rather than just by yourself. But still, some birds get eaten, and that's just part of roosting in a group. But the vegetation is of the right character for these birds. They tend to like riparian vegetation. They don't typically roost out in the big exposed cottonwoods. Again, that would be pretty vulnerable to an owl, which is really the main predator on these birds, is great horned owls. And so by roosting down in willows and smaller vegetation, either the stuff that was around the lake on Foster Island or exactly what you guys have out here, those birds can get down in really thick vegetation. I'm surprised at night when it gets really dark, they just drop right down into the thickest part of that. And they may only be this high off the ground, but they are in a kind of a cage of willow, and if anything taps on the side of that willow, that kind of reverberates through the whole group, and they all immediately flush out of there. So it's a really good early warning system. That kind of vegetation seems to match perfectly for what they need. They're not really coming in to eat or drink or anything like that right at the site here. It's all about safety for the night. And also, instead of roosting way out in the a more rural setting, you know, they could be up in the conifers outside of Monroe, for example, and be quite safe there, but it's also a lot colder there. So here, by being in an urban area and, of course, lower elevation, they're in a nice thermal climate as well as a fairly good predator-free area. So that's really why they're here. They're balancing the costs of where they're going to eat, the dangers of predators, and the thermal regime that they're living in. And they are also using that big social gathering for lots of information, and for their, each bird in there probably has a kind of a different reason from an information standpoint or a social standpoint to be in that roost. Some might be looking for a new mate or a mate. Some might be looking to find a new place to eat and follow others the next day to that. Or they may be just, you know, getting together and shooting the breeze like we do when we gather in big groups. We really don't know. We don't know how structured the birds are within those roosts at all. I've always dreamed of having all the birds painted different colors from the different places where they're during the day and then see if they group together like that at night, but nobody knows if that's the case or not. We do know from telemetry studies we had done about 10 years ago now that individuals don't always go to the same roost, and individuals from many different places will move around between roosts, especially young birds. So they, you know, this might be a little unusual now in having such a large number. It might be more stable, but still I bet a lot of these birds shift between some of those places I mentioned on a night-to-night basis. And that will happen more and more as the spring blooms more, and those birds are going to start setting up territories. They already have territories, but they're going to start spending most of their time on their territories, the adults, and some of the young that help and live with those adults. They won't be all coming in here every night. In the next month, almost half of those birds are going to be sitting on nests somewhere, the females, and they're not going to come into roost in a group at all once they're doing that. So the numbers in this roost will decline a little bit throughout the summer. Then they'll start building up again in August, and they'll be high throughout the fall. There's also some birds in this roost that are coming probably from a long distance. There might be birds from Alaska or Eastern Washington. I don't know, but I can tell you we've been catching birds from that roosting group for the experiments I'll tell you a little bit about, and some of them are 550 grams, really big crows that are much more like crows from the central part of the state or Canada, maybe even as far as Alaska. Because some places in the northern part of their range, those birds migrate. Ours typically don't here, but we might get an influx of some of these birds from more northern climes. So might have a real mix of individuals here. Some of them will migrate away, some of them will be breeding and out of your hair, but you'll still have quite a few birds throughout the summer, I would guess, at that roost. Okay, so I'll come, if you've got any questions on that, I can deal with it, but I'd like to tell you just a little bit about these birds now, their general behavior, and some of the things that you might not know that they're capable of doing, and some of the things we've been researching on the Seattle campus to try to understand them better. So here's all the, some of the weird things people have told me that crows do. And as Janice said, I'm going to show you some illustrations from Tony Angel. And this is the first one, and this was a story we were told about soaring ravens in this case. And what's neat about this, many of you probably have seen crows as they come in, they flutter around and do lots of neat acrobatics, and ravens especially, if you've been over along the Columbia or in other places, the Grand Canyon's a great spot to see them soaring and twisting and turning. Well, in this case, in Rocky Mountain National Park, they took it one step further. And these ravens are using surfboards, basically, little barks, pieces of bark that they're holding in their feet, and they're using that to ride the air currents. So they use tools. They have fun. They slide down snowy slopes like these ravens are. How many of you have seen the YouTube video of the crow in Russia on a little top, a container top, sliding down a snowy roof? If you haven't seen that, I would Google it. It's pretty awesome. And these birds, ravens do it without, they don't need a sled. You know, crows need a little extra. These guys just slide right down. And the cool thing is they get up and do it again and repeat this behavior. There's captive birds. A lot of people have had pet crows and ravens. Here's one from Copenhagen Zoo that played with a ball, just on and on and on and on, throwing a ball up and down like a dog might. And another pet crow a woman told me about that would tease the family cat with this shoelace. They got along fine. So these birds are able to demonstrate insight as well. This is a kind of a diagram of an experiment done on the New Caledonia crow, which some of you may have heard of, a tool user. And not all crows use tools, but the ones in New Caledonia, it's a different species, they are experts at it. And there's no woodpeckers on that island. So they use tools to get into crevices where bugs occur, like a woodpecker would use elsewhere. And our American crows have been seen using tool sticks to get spiders, but it's very rare. But this New Caledonia crow, the interesting thing about this experiment is that it really is the best demonstration of insight that we know of from birds. And that is the ability to see a problem and understand it and then solve it by that understanding. And the reason I say that with this experiment is it's a demonstration of what we call meta-tool use, or using tools to get tools to solve a problem. And the problem in this case is getting the food out of this clear plastic tube here. It's a bit of food, and the bird needs to use a long stick to get that food out. But to get the long stick, it has to use a short stick to get it out of that cage in the middle. And to use the small stick, it has to pull up a string, which is not easy in itself. To pull up a string, they have to pull it, step on it, re-grip, pull, step, and not drop the string. So birds that never use this whole sequence at all, the first time they were presented this sequence of apparatus, they immediately went over, pulled up the string, got the small stick to get the big to get the food. They didn't mess around with just trying to get the big stick without a stick, or to take the small stick over and try to get the food. They put all three steps together right away. And the birds that pulled the small stick, they had experience doing that before, but they were never rewarded for it, and in fact that behavior was extinguished before the experiment started. Yep. Yes, seconds. And I think there were 7 or 9 birds in this group, and they all solved it. So it was pretty impressive. Yeah, it was individual, independent trials.
Are they the same?
Yeah, so ravens and crows are not the same. They're in the same genus, same family of birds, the corvids, but ravens around here are confined to the mountains and the coasts. Occasionally you could get one here. I live in Maltby, and we do have them flying over there. So you could occasionally get one to come by here, but mostly Monroe up the Cascades is where you'll get them here, or the Olympics, or on the coast. They're bigger. They're the size of a red-tailed hawk, you know, 1.5 kilograms, and the 4-foot wingspan as compared to our crows, which are like this and a wingspan like this. So different, but I'll use them interchangeably. Sorry about that, just because they're kind of demonstrating the same sorts of things. So here's a raven demonstrating risk-taking behavior, which some birds don't do, but these guys do. This raven would sit in the middle of I-5 and eat, in this case, was eating a dead jackrabbit in California where it was reported, and as cars would come by, it would just duck down and let the cars speed over him, going 70 miles an hour. Rise back up, eat, next car comes, right back down, and the car goes over it. So pretty risky behavior, and it's been reported now with crows in Seattle doing the same thing at slower speeds. And, you know, this behavior of risk-taking is rooted probably in their response to predators like bald eagles here, which I'm sure you've seen right on your campus. You'll have crows diving at bald eagles, seeming to try to harass these predators and get them out of the area. And that's what they're doing. There's a benefit of alerting a predator to the knowledge that the crow has that the predator's there, so the element of surprise is taken away from the predator, and usually the predator will leave. But occasionally, as they're diving at him, the predator will just go grab the crow right out of the air and kill it and eat it. And eagles are predators on crows' nests, just like the red-tailed hawks are as well, on the young in the nests. They're also delinquents. They smoke, they drink. They drink beer. They drink Raven's Brew coffee is a favorite in Alaska that they drink. And these birds from the Maldives, house crows, were caught taking cigarettes out of a pack. We don't know if they inhaled, but they do have cannabinoid receptors and other opioid receptors in their brains, so I wouldn't be surprised if they did. They also get into battles, again, using weapons in this case. This was an observation that my major professor actually made at his bird feeder in Arizona. And a Steller's jay came into the feeder. Another member of the same group of birds, family Corvidae, came in with a stick in its bill, pointed end out, and started going after a crow that was at the feeder with it. The crow didn't want any part of that, took the stick from the jay and chased the jay out with the stick. And they're mischievous. Maybe this is related to predation or trying to get food from predators, but I'm getting ready to take a class to Yellowstone Saturday, and we'll be watching ravens do this kind of thing to wolves there. They pinch wolves' tails. They take dogs and do the same thing. Here, a meerkat being pinched by a large African raven. And why they do it is not really for sure, but a lot of times it distracts a predator. You might see them do it to a bald eagle at a salmon carcass around here would be the most common thing. They'll pull on the tail, the eagle will swing around, and another bird will come in from the other side and steal the food. In this case, it may have just been goofing around with this meerkat. In Japan, the Japanese crows there, jungle crows, take candles from Shinto shrines, and that's what Tony's illustrated here. And that's bad enough, but when they drop these lit candles around, they start fires quite regularly with them, and that's a real problem. And when we saw this interesting behavior, it made us think of some of the legends that we're all familiar with here, especially the raven bringing the light to the world, or stealing the light. Lots of different versions of that in different legends around the northern hemisphere. And it may very well be related to this sort of behavior. Think of some of the early seal oil lamps that Inuits had, various Eskimos had. And those are just fat. These are tallow candles as well. And so it's just food for the bird. And they may very well have been going in stealing those sorts of lighted devices to get food. And it might have spawned some of these thoughts about them bringing or stealing the light to light the world. In the North Cascades, if any of you met Hitchcock, the raven at there in New Halem? So Hitchcock is a bad raven. He was a bad raven. He's rehabilitated, but he was stealing windshield wipers from people's cars. Everybody's cars, basically, at the New Halem campground. And this is not uncommon. It's been observed in ravens and crows in a lot of different places, from the Netherlands to Southern California. And we don't know what they have about rubber, but they like it. They like the feel of it for some reason. They pull it, they take it off, and they typically just drop it right there. But we took advantage of this bird's intelligence to try to condition him not to do this. And so we caught him, and we then restrained him. And what we typically do to catch a bird is we'll bait them into food, and we shoot a net that goes over the top of them and constrains them. And we run up there, and that's got to be scary, these big thing running up and grabbing you out of a net. And we hold them for maybe 10 or 15 minutes as we put bands on so we can identify the birds, and then we let them go. So in this case, what we did when we caught Hitchcock is we held him on the car, right on a windshield wiper, as we banded him. So he had about 10 minutes of terror while he was right there with the windshield wiper. And our hope was that he might start then to associate windshield wiper with a very bad experience when we let him go, and he might stay away from windshield wipers. And his behavior definitely declined after that, but the park also gave out PVC pipe to everybody who came in to the park to put over their windshield wipers. So they reduced the ability of the bird to get at the food, and we had conditioned him that it was a bad thing if he did, and his behavior dropped off, and he's been a model citizen ever since. So these birds also can imitate human language quite well, and they use it to their advantage, it seems. Have any of you had a pet crow or a raven that talked or heard one talk?
Not a crow, but my dad had a
minor bird. Uh-huh. So they're not a corvid, but it's the same sort of thing. They can mimic voice. Parrots, of course, mimic voice quite well. These guys take it a step above. So Kevin was a guy in Missoula. He was a wildlife biologist who went to the University of Montana, and he was awakened one morning by his dog barking like crazy in his backyard. And Kevin went out there, it was like 6 in the morning, went out there to shut his dog up. Vampire, be quiet, be quiet. He's yelling at his dog, and the dog wouldn't stop barking, and the person calling the dog wouldn't stop yelling at him either. He kept saying, here, boy, come on, let's go, come on, let's go. And Kevin was like, give it a break, man. Quit messing with my dog. And then a crow pops up from behind the dog's cage saying, come on, boy, let's go, whistling to the crow, whistling to the dog. Well, this dog got quite a reputation around Missoula for the next few weeks. It would go around and gather up dogs from the neighborhoods and bring them to campus. So you think you have it bad with the crows. Wait till they start bringing all the dogs in here. You're going to have a problem. So here's the dog. He's called in all, or the crows called in all these dogs to the campus, has them in the oval, and he's keeping them there until the students get out of class. And when the students get out of class and walk between classes, the crow would take off, and all the dogs would follow and run through the students. And, you know, I would guess there was one or two bags of potato chips or sandwiches dropped during the course of this that might have rewarded the crow for its behavior. But it was quite a scene, and well detailed. So he was using this voice that he had learned probably as a pet in an appropriate way to get perhaps something that he needed, food in this case, or just a chuckle. So they also have various emotions. Crows have been reported by lots of people to have funerals, and that's what Tony's illustrated here. And so there's a dead crow, and I saw this actually right on your overpass here this summer. A crow dead on the road, and the whole road and all the guardrails and everything covered with crows looking at it. And so you might think, what's going on in their brain? Are they really feeling, sorrow for this? Are they afraid? I think they're probably really just learning about a very dangerous situation. So they come in and they respond to a dead crow just like they respond to an eagle or another threatening item in their environment. And they're all scolding and they're looking and they're very anxious and they're probably very attentive to anything about that place. The location, the kind of cars that were there, the people or the dogs that were there. They're learning about all those potential dangers when they come in and have this sort of gathering. Now, they may also be feeling bad about it, but I think mostly they're using it as a learning experience. Yeah? They don't typically eat the dead bird. No, they don't. And they'll eat just about everything else, of course. So, no, they don't. I mean, they will if you force them to, but not typically. It'll just stay there. So oftentimes when you don't see many crows run over on the road, but when you do in the late spring, early summer, when young birds are get run over, they'll be on the road for a long time, unlike things like a possum or a squirrel. All right, so how do they do this? I think there are three real keys to why these birds are so smart. First off, they have big brains for their body size. So this graph just shows the brain size versus body size of different animals. And there's just a general relationship between brain and body size for all organisms. So fish, this is the average line for the brain and body size relationship of fish, and then birds, and then mammals and primates are what the lines are. And typically fish have smaller brains than birds, and birds smaller brains than mammals, but big ones have bigger brains than smaller ones of the same group. Okay? So you have something like from a hummingbird, really small brain, to an ostrich up there, big bird, which is well below the average line, kind of a pin-headed bird, small brain for its body size. The crows and ravens and jays are all up well above the bird line. They're up on either the mammal line or the primate line. So these crows that you have here have brains the size of small monkeys of that same size, I should say. And the other birds that are right up there with them are the large parrots, the macaws. In this case, big long-tailed macaws. So that group of birds is exceptional in having large brains, and it's especially the large forebrain where they integrate sensory information and act upon it that's enlarged in those birds. They're also, as you know, very social, so they can learn from each other. They don't have to learn everything from their own experience, and that's a real benefit, as we know, that you can learn things quickly without danger, as much danger. And again, maybe coming into where an animal was killed, you'd think that's a risky behavior, but it's actually a really good way to learn about danger rather than having to experience it yourself. And they're long-lived, so they have a long time which they can gather these experiences. It's not uncommon for the crows that are coming in here, they've already survived through the worst times when they're very young or in the nest, or maybe that first year out of the nest. So these birds, I bet there are 30, 40-year-old birds that are coming in this group of 10,000, let's say. Certainly there's a lot of birds that are 4, 5, 10 years old, and there are a few really ancient ones, I'm sure, in that group. Their mortality is less than 5% a year once they become 2 years old. Okay, so I'm going to give you a little brain stuff now, and this, you can just tune this out if you want to, but I think it's fascinating. I will try to be as brief as I can with it, but I want you to know that the brain of a crow is a lot like the brain of a person, okay? They have two hemispheres, just like we do. As Tony's shown here, right and left hemisphere. They don't have the gnarled, cortex that we have on the outside of our brain that you see, that kind of cauliflower-shaped thing that you recognize as a brain. There's a smooth, but it's layered. There are various layers that are illustrated there. There's a midbrain and a hindbrain and a forebrain. The grayer areas there are the more forebrain areas where a lot of these really important connections among things like a loud noise or being caught in a net and associating that with a person may be made. Okay, so we know a lot more about the brain of a bird now. It's constructed by the same proteins and genes that construct ours. It's just done in patches instead of layers so much as ours is, and it's not convoluted on the outside like ours is. It has a lot of functions that we know of that bird brains do. Okay, some of those are shown here. Everything from just taking in sensory information, like I think there's a place here that'll come up later for you, the entopallium, where visual information comes in, the hippocampus, where memory comes in, the amygdala, you might have heard in humans and mammals, that's where our emotional behavior basically comes from. It has places that sends commands down to its muscles to make them behave. So these birds are taking in information, acting upon it in their brain, and that's commanding their muscles to do the interesting behaviors we see, like playing or whatever it is. Some of the various ways sensory inputs come in. This is the one that shows the entopallium. Just remember that name, entopallium. That's where visual information comes in from the eyes into that part of the forebrain. Different places is where the information from their ears comes in and from the touch sensations in their beaks especially are very, very sensitive, and a lot of information about their environment comes in through that route. But different places in their brain take these different sensory inputs, and they're integrated in different places, but especially the striatum. Remember that word, striatum. It's part of the brain. We've got the exact same part in our brain called the same thing. It's kind of a lower part of the brain, a more primitive part of the brain, if you want to think of it that way. That's where a lot of the connections among different sorts of neurons are made. Sensory neurons, memory neurons, emotional neurons, if you want to think of it that way. They come together, they actually form physical connections among each other in places like the striatum. And places like the striatum are where dopamine comes and motivates an animal to do things. Motivates us to behave and allows us to behave in a very nuanced way. If anybody's ever had anybody in their family who's had Parkinson's disease, you know what the problem is if you don't have dopamine. You can't control those connections very well between the various neurons in your brain. So birds function the same way. They use dopamine to motivate their actions and to make their expectations felt, basically. If you're expecting something, you have a lot of dopamine in your system that allows you to react when that expectation is or isn't realized. So they have the same sorts of ways that they see and integrate their view of the world as we do. They also, this is just a cut through the back of the middle of the brain, just again to show some of the places, but more importantly, just to make the point that they have lots of these same chemicals, like dopamine, that we have that motivate our behavior. They also are motivated by opioids. For when they do pleasurable activities, they get a rush of endorphins, just like we do, and that gives them presumably the same warm feeling it gives us when we do something pleasurable. So when that raven is sliding down a slope of snow, it's probably feeling pretty good in the same, really the same way we do, the same chemicals giving them that feeling that it gives us. And as I mentioned, dopamine is giving them the same sort of anticipation, motivation to do things that it tends to give us. I haven't communicated with the birds to ask them if they really feel this way, but there's no reason to suspect they wouldn't. They have the same machinery in their brain that we do, and that machinery in our brain gives us an awful lot of the way we feel and perceive the world. All right, that's all for your brain stuff for a little while. We'll come back to what we're learning about the brain of the birds here in Seattle in a second. But first off, just to make the point that these birds, as you know, live with people. That, to me, is one thing that makes them so interesting, is that they're not birds that you have to travel to the middle of the Amazon to observe. Rather, you can step out of your backyard and see them. And you can read about various things that people have done, and you hear about these birds in those readings all the time. They've influenced us for a long, long time. So this diagram that Tony did shows basically this idea that we call cultural coevolution. Their cultures, the socially learned behaviors of these animals has influenced our cultures, our writings, our poems, our rock band names of today, the sports teams' names of today that we have. They've influenced Asian art. They've influenced legends in Norway and Scandinavia, as well as England, and of course here in the Pacific Northwest for millennia. They were around well before people were interacting with other predators and scavengers, like they now interact with us. So initially they were scavenging from some of the other wild animals, like wolves in particular. Ravens and wolves have a close association. Crows probably had a close association scavenging along coasts in early days before people were around. And when people came on the scene, we just provided everything these birds needed. Lots of extra food were associated with our encampments, or our slaughtering places and our activities. And they took advantage of us, and that's influenced the way we've viewed them, much as it's influenced the way you all are viewing the birds here on campus now. So you're not the first or the last to have been influenced by these animals and really trying to understand them and perhaps even drawing motivation from them. So because of that, they have a very strong propensity to be able to recognize us. And I got an email from a woman in Sweden that told me about one of the ways that they have this, they've demonstrated this ability to her quite clearly. And this is an illustration of magpies, which some of you may be familiar with from the east side of the mountains. It's a different species now, but it's very closely related, occurs around the Northern Hemisphere, in Europe as well. And you'll see them in cities and towns in Europe. And in Sweden, this woman had fed them a little bit in her backyard. And then she started noticing weird things happening around her house. The doorbell would ring and nobody was there. And she'd go out and, what's going on? Nobody's here. She'd see the magpies across the way. She'd throw them a little food. She kept doing that. The birds kept ringing the doorbell until finally one day she saw them on the doorbell. And that's this gilded lion here. And the magpies pushing the tongue down, which is the lever to cause the bell to ring. And it's cool that they were doing this at this door, because this wasn't the door they typically went in and out of. The family went in and out of it all. There was another door just like it around the corner. And the birds kind of took the knowledge of seeing people come and go from there to this other door. Perhaps it's a less dangerous place for them. And invoked the behavior of getting people to come out and take care of them there. So that was all cool for the woman, but the husband did not like this. Again, like here, you either like or you don't like these animals. You either like them a lot or hate them. And with the magpies, the husband was not at all thrilled. His culture was that these were birds you shouldn't have around your house. It was fine to have finches and things like that, but don't let the magpies around. They'll steal all your shiny objects and things like that, bring bad luck. So he started acting like he was throwing. He said he never threw anything, but he acted like he threw something at him. From that day on, they started crapping on his car. They would whitewash his window of his car every day, only on the driver's side, so that he would spend like 10 minutes every day cleaning his car before he could go to work. He'd move his car and switch it with his wife's. Never got his wife's, only got his car. So, Chancellor, as you're going into the parking area, just say hello to the birds and wave and you'll be all right. But it makes sense that these kind of pressures would lead the birds to be able to recognize us and respond to us appropriately. So in our area here, both of these sorts of people live in close proximity. In fact, people just like this live in my neighborhood, both ends of this. You can hunt crows here. It's legal to. It's not an illegal activity. It is in neighborhoods illegal to shoot. But you can hunt crows, and crows need to know that some people are deadly, very dangerous. And other people spend their whole lives feeding the birds. Phyllis, you may have read about her in the newspaper about 10 years ago now, I think. She was a bus driver in Bellevue. Not a good thing, not a good occupation for someone who feeds crows every day, because they followed her on her bus route and into her place of work every day. But they knew her. As soon as she drove in, I went out with her to a parking lot. And as soon as she drove in that lot, I hadn't seen any crows. She pulls in and whoosh, there was a black cloud on her car to get food. So if you want a reliable food source or stay away from a dangerous one, you need to know people. and you need to be able to discriminate them. And because we change and different people come and go in areas, pick up these different habits, it's a rapidly changing selective pressure in their environment. And that favors learning as opposed to some genetic, you know, predisposition to either come towards all people or go away from them. So we tried to test these experiments. Some of you have heard of some of these results, but I'll just go through them with you quickly. So we on campus caught 7 crows using that same net I described for the raven, and we did it wearing this mask of a caveman because it was cheap on the internet. So I thought, well, we'll get that mask. We caught the birds, and we wanted to then, the cool thing was I wanted to be able to let anybody wear that mask and see if they'd respond to that face later on, okay? Rather than only my face or others of us, we'd all thought they recognized us when we caught birds and monitored their nests before, but you know, maybe it's the way we looked at them, the way we walked or something about that. So we could isolate the face with the caveman. We use a control face, Dick Cheney at the time. I think I'm looking for a Rick Santorum mask. If anybody's got one, we'll go for that next. But he was the good guy in this case, okay? He was the neutral face. We never caught birds with Dick Cheney, but it was a face and a mask that just in case they responded to masks in general. And so here are the results of what we did. We actually wore that mask with the hat when we caught the birds. And what we recorded was how many of the birds would attack us, scold and dive at us just like they do to a hawk or an eagle. Okay, it's called scolding or mobbing behavior. And it's very obvious. Anybody, when you see it, you know it. I mean, the birds are looking at you and screaming and diving down at you. So before we caught any birds, we just walked around campus with either no mask or the Dick Cheney or the caveman and hat, and we basically didn't get any response. Occasionally a bird would scold, and that was probably related to another predator going by, but it was very, very rare. Then after we caught birds, again, they responded a little bit to Cheney and none to a person without a mask, but a lot to anybody who wore the mask. And if they wore just the mask or just the hat or the both of them or even the mask upside down, they responded very strongly to that. And the upside down face was interesting because mammals don't recognize upside down faces very well. When you look at an inverted face, it looks really, it looks strange. You don't immediately think, oh, that's that caveman face. That's because we see the whole image as one and we interpret that. Birds identify individual pieces of faces and other complex pictures. So they can put together the pieces in any of them. It doesn't matter what order they're in. They recognize, oh, those are the parts of the whole, and they respond to it. I didn't know that when we did these experiments, but I'd seen in pigeons and other and mammals didn't do that. So I thought, well, it's worth trying, and it was neat because they responded very strongly to that. Sometimes they'd even look at us, like some of you guys are doing. They'd look at us when we were wearing that upside down mask, and they'd turn their heads upside down and rotate it and look at us that way as well.
What about color?
Yep, that's a great question, and it's extreme. Okay, it's an extreme face. So what we did is we actually then took molds off of some of our friends and students. And made, I've got a lot of faces in my lab right now. So, and they are very realistic. They're rubber, latex, soft face that you can put on. They have different styles of hair. We had male, female, white, and Caucasian, or white and Asian, faces. And we mixed all those up, and some were dangerous some places and not dangerous others, and we got the same results, basically. So they really recognized individual faces that captured them in the past, and they don't respond to very much to faces that didn't capture them. But you're right, this one is extreme, but it's convenient. It's on campus, so I've kept doing that. And something that's been surprising is how long-lasting this recognition of the face has been. We caught birds in 2006. When I made this slide in 2011, I still had strong responses by birds to that face. We just tested it on the 6-year anniversary in February of this year, and again we got between 70 and 50% of all the birds we encountered scolded that face. The student that wore the dangerous face the first time for that trial, he walked out of my building, my office building, and he got about from here across the hall out the door here, and he had a mob of 7 birds on him immediately. Those birds had not seen that mask on campus for 6 months and only seen it once during the summer. And it was 6 years ago when they'd had any negative experience with it. So they are really on patrol waiting for this guy to come out, and whenever he comes out, they're on him, and everybody else learns about him. Because you'll see, there's a lot of birds. You know, this is just percentage of the animals, but on a typical walk, we'd encounter 20 or 30 crows. So those dots on the end here are somewhere in the neighborhood of 15 to 20 birds scolding. And we only caught 7 birds. And hardly any of those, even 15 or 20 that scold, are those 7 that we initially caught. So they've learned from one another that this is a dangerous person. And that's shown in this slide a little bit. Basically, these are the birds we captured with the caveman or other dangerous face. And when we could see those birds again respond to that dangerous face, they were very accurate. They all scolded it for the most part. And they didn't scold the neutral mask or the person without any mask. They were very accurate. Here are the birds that were never captured. They were unbanded. We never touched them before. And about half of those birds scolded the negative face when they saw it. And they didn't scold the other face very much at all. So they were also very accurate. Not as accurate as those with personal experience, but from their social experience, joining in the scolding mob of others that were attacking us, they came to know that face. Yeah, a little. Well, I don't know. I know a little bit about how they do it in these ways. I know that some of them learn by our initial capture, because we have cases where the first time we come to an area when we wore these other masks, like in one of them was in downtown in Freeway Park. First time we came there after we captured birds, we were scolded by birds that were by themselves that were not banded. So the only way they could have learned about that dangerous person was to see us catch other birds with that face on. Or maybe we just missed them with the net, for example. Others learn from being in the mob. And by being in that mob, they're learning from their peers. Okay? And others learn from their parents. Because we could go in and test parents and their young that were born after we trapped. So those birds had no idea this was a dangerous face. They weren't even alive when it was dangerous. But their parents scold us, and those young start to scold us with their parents, and then we can come in later when their parents aren't there, and they scold us. So we know they learn from a variety of different routes. And again, that's pretty unusual. You know, this is something that you wouldn't be surprised to see in a monkey society. But for birds to be able to learn from their peers, their parents, and their individual observations and experiences, that's very complex. And again, living a long time and being social and having that large brain to put that information together is why crows are able to do this sort of thing. Yep.
In general, how do they react to you?
Without a mask?
Yeah, just you walking around.
So now they don't respond too much to me. Some do. Some that I caught do. But most of the birds don't. And we caught, the last time I probably caught birds on campus without a mask on was probably about 10 years ago. So it gradually goes away. But that gets reinforced every time we walk with the mask now, because if one bird scolds, it attracts others in to scold. And they're all learning and reinforcing that negative aspect of that face, even though they're not seeing it do anything bad. They're just hearing about it being bad.
Was there any, like, for example, if I wore a white
hat? Yeah, there's a gardener that wears a straw hat like that on campus, and he's not real happy. I mean, he's cool about it, but he does get some attention. Yeah. Yes? Yes, we had the mask on. That's a good question. So when we wear a mask, we catch a bird, we have it on the entire time. It's looking at us the entire time we've got that bird. Then we band it and let it go. So we haven't gone that far. We're just getting this quarter. Again, I've got some students who are going to wear the mask and go far off campus. At year 3, here's our main route on the main part of campus here, going up through upper campus. And these are the neighborhoods around the U, down by the fisheries area and then neighborhoods around the campus. And we got some scolding after 3 years there, like you would expect from social learning. But it was very little. And I'm really curious now, we're going to try it and see 3 years later, do we get any more? But it's very likely that some of the birds that come up here certainly were in a mob scolding that face on campus. But there's 10,000 birds, so, you know, hitting the right one, it's a bit of a game. But We're going to try and see. All right, so what we've been doing is trying to understand how this, what goes on in the bird's brain when it sees this dangerous face. Does it, is there really anything unique going on there, and how similar is it to what people do when they see a dangerous face? So the nice thing about our campuses is that there's lots of interesting people to interact with, and I had the fortunate case of being able to interact with a couple of the neuroscientists there. Donna Cross is in the Department of Radiology, and this is Robert Miyoka. He's also in the Department of Radiology, and they have a PET scanner. You may have had a PET scan done on you at some time to check for various diseases or malfunctioning organs in your body. It's not an MRI, but it's very similar to that. So these guys and their technicians and my students, this is Greg and Heather is a student, they have helped us be able to really peer inside of the crow's brain as it sees different people. So this is the experiment that I'll tell you about. We catch a bird from the wild. Like I said, we were catching them right out here by the Brightwater treatment plant. Catch birds, bring them into captivity, keep them on top of a building on campus, and when we caught them, we wore, that's one of the more realistic looking masks there, that's Joe, that's holding the bird in number two. So all the time that bird is being grabbed and held, and every time he's taken out of a cage, he sees Joe. When he's living in his aviary up on the roof, he sees Michelle feed him all the time, a different face. And we can rotate those. We've had some of the birds I'll show you had Joe as a dangerous and some Joe as a caring face. But would they see two people, basically, one that feeds them and hoses out their cages and one that catches them. And then we take a bird after 2 weeks. We take it and bring it over to Robert's lab, put it in a smaller cage there in number four, let it sit overnight, and the next morning we reach into that cage through a blanket so it doesn't see us, grab it, cover its face so it can't see us, give it a shot of glucose with a radioactive label in the glucose, okay? Just like you would get. That glucose is taken up by their cells where the cells are most active, using the most energy. That glucose is used, and because of the label in it, it doesn't go all the way down the Krebs cycle, and it sticks in those areas where that glucose is most active. That's what we then, after we do that, we put the bird back in its cage, and we can expose it. We've got about 20 minutes where we can have it do some behavior. If they made tools, I'd have them make tools. Whatever we can get them do in that 20 minutes, we can allow them to do it, and the tracer is accumulating in the part of their brain that's active during that time. Okay? So here they're looking at Joe sitting out there for on and off. We cover and reveal and cover and reveal the bird to be able to see the dangerous or caring face. Then we anesthetize them and scan them to see what part of their brains were active. Then they wake up, they get a nice meal of hot dogs or hamburgers, boiled eggs, dog food. They go back up on the roof. They have to stay for a day is all. Clear out the radioactive tracer, and then we can let them go. So we can bring the birds in, and now we're down. We have them in for a total of 3 weeks. 2 weeks to acclimate, a week to do the experiments on six birds and let them go. And during that time, we can assess their response to different things, like in this case, the caring or dangerous face. So here's what the brain of a crow looks like. This is a 3D look. I'll show it's a quick video clip. You'll just see it spin around. But I want you to just notice on this, the big ball in the front is the eye. Okay, a lot of activity there as they're seeing and looking out there. And the bright spot right in the middle, that's that entopallium. That's where visual information in the cortex of their brain is first going to be assessed. And then you see other parts of the brain you'll see as it spins around a little bit more. But see it just, see now you've got both hemispheres of the brain, okay? Two entopalia, one on either side, that's processing that sight, looking at that dangerous person. The cerebellum is what's hanging down in the middle there, and both eyes are active. So you can get a really good look at the brain of a crow in a pretty non-invasive way. Yeah, we've got to catch the bird, we've got to hold it, we give it a shot of glucose, but, you know, for the most part, the bird's alive and healthy and back on his way in a few days, and we can get a nice image in terms of what's going on in its brain without having to dissect it. So here's what we found. When this is a case when the birds are looking at either the dangerous or the caring face. And the top row up there, what it shows is an MRI of a crow's brain, the gray part. That just shows what the structure of the brain, where we're at. And the coloring on that are where there were significant differences in the activity of that area when they saw a person versus looked out and saw no person. So we had 9 crows that looked out and saw a person, and 3 crows that looked out and just saw the empty lab. Okay? And the birds that looked out and saw a person had a lot of activity in their forebrain. That's the nidopallium, mesopallium, and hyperpallium, the N, M, and H up there. That's like our visual cortex in our forebrain. Just like the exact same areas that would be activated when you saw a person, someplace in your cortex first. The next one is the striatum, the lateral striatum that's active in the middle there. That's the part where these complex associations are being formed. So they're probably expecting these people to do something, either catch them or feed them, and we're not. We're just sitting there. And because of that, the expectation isn't met. That part of the brain should be very active. It's not matching what they expected, and that's what we see there. And that's the same. Those two areas are certainly very active in humans when we look out at faces as well. Now this shows a little more detail about what happens if they look at the face that caught them versus the face that's been caring for them relative to no face. So that same slide I just showed you, we're just going to split it up. And the first row are the 5 birds that were looking at the threatening face. And the middle row is the 4 birds that were looking at the caring face. Okay, and then the bottom row is just the difference between those. Actually, it's the difference where there was more to threat than the caring face. So again, you see in the first couple of slides, and I should say these slices, these are virtual slices starting at the front of the crow brain and going to the back. So you see the eyes showing up there in this very far, the A21. And back here, it's the back of the brain. You just see the back of the two lobes and the what do you call that thing? The brainstem. Yes, thank you. That's hanging down there. All right, so we've got visual processing on both those, pretty similar. The difference occurs in the middle and back of the brain. So in response to the dangerous face on top, the threatening face, on A5.8 up there, you see A and TNA. That's the amygdala of a bird that's being activated by seeing a dangerous face. Their emotion is one of fear in this case. It's a very standard response of animals, including humans, to fear learning and fearful things like this face that caught them. There are parts of the brainstem that are activated too. BS there is brainstem. And those are areas that our resolution isn't precise enough to identify which place, but a lot of those areas are places that control fear reflexes in birds. In the middle row, the response to the caring face, again, the medial striatum, the MST, and the preoptic area are active there at A14.2, and they weren't active on the bird that was seeing the dangerous face. So those are places that are associated with hunger reflexes in birds and also these learned associations. So I think what this suggests is that the bird was expecting food when they saw that caring face come up to them. It makes sense. I don't know for sure, but it makes sense that it would be that and would be different than the dangerous face. So the other thing that's interesting, just like in humans, there's a bias to which hemisphere is most activated by a threatening versus non-threatening stimulus. In our case, if we see a friendly person, the left hemisphere of our brain is most active. And that's the same thing that's active. When you look at it here, it's the right side, but remember the birds turn like this, so it's actually their left hemisphere that's active in the caring face, and it's the right hemisphere that's active mostly to the dangerous stimuli. So there's some lateralization of the response in their brain, much like it is in humans and other mammals. Okay, so I have just one more story for you, and then I'll take whatever questions you guys have. This one comes from Marysville, and it suggests that maybe some of these ways that birds interact with us is a lot more complex than we've given them credit for. And after what we've seen can go on in their brain, the sorts of associations they can make, perhaps it's not all that surprising. So Gary emailed me, and this is a guy that he cooks chicken and cuts it up and prepares it daily for birds, for crows that come to his house. He's really, really into this. And he sent me an email, and he said, you know, I feed these crows every day, and one day I went out to feed my birds, and I said to them, I feed you every day, and you never give me anything. Why don't you give me something? And that afternoon on his feeder was this candy conversation heart with the word love on it. So as most of you and I were very tempted to delete that email and hope we never heard from Gary again, I stuck with it and talked to Gary and saw the heart, saw these other things that birds had left on his feeder, this butterfly and sticks and cones and pieces of cement, all kinds of weird things showed up there. So I thought, well, we can make this a science project. We can try to figure out why this might have happened. And here's several hypotheses, what could have gone on here with the crow. And we can kind of work down through these and see if we can reject some and progress. Well, let's take the chain-pulling hypothesis. This is what I figured. I figured Gary's wife was doing this to him, you know, goofing around with him. But no, she's handicapped. The feeder is out in the back. That's this table in his backyard off the deck with chicken on it here. And she can't get out there. He's got a fence around his yard. He doesn't have kids or grandkids. His neighbors are not real happy with all these crows that come in every day to his yard, as you could relate to. So I don't think they would have left anything that said love on it, on his feeder, and I don't think they would have gotten back there. So I don't think Gary was being duped. And I then started getting lots of other accounts of this behavior. Okay, he's not the only one. So I was on a radio, and a woman called in from Indiana and said she was just sitting out in her yard, and a crow swooped down, landed on her, and gave her a bead. Another woman got a red and white rocket. Leona gets shiny glass in her bird feeder every day after the crows come in. And Eric gets shiny objects, including glass and metal and things from magpies that visit his feeder. He puts out mice just for magpies in his barn. And Beth was feeding crows in Seattle. Tony's drawn this little sequence here, dropping kibble on the road, and she heard a key clink. Turned around, the crows had dropped this key. She picked it up, and it was to a brand new Mercedes-Benz. She drove and lived happily ever after. It wasn't actually for a car, but it was a nice connection of, oh, the crows really did drop this gift here. And another woman, we've had lots, even many more of these since, another woman got a whole collection of things, and she's held on to this blue Cap'n Crunch figurine for 20 years that she got from the crow. So these things mean a lot to the people that get them, and they just make you think, wow, what's going on here? So back to our hypotheses. There wasn't writing and discussion with the crows and the people in all these cases. So I think we can reject that hypothesis that they knew what the heart meant and left it for Gary. And we're left really with two hypotheses. It could be a mistake. The birds were carrying this thing around and found something better. Dog kibble or whatever it was, took the food and dropped the toy. Why they were carrying it around in the first place, I don't know. Why they wouldn't come back, get these things, don't know. But it seems likely that that could be the case. For whatever reason, they were attracted to this object and carried it and left it for something better. And we have some predictions we could follow up on with that. It could also be adaptive. It could be a way that these birds are kind of keeping us on the dole to give them more each time. I mean, they form these complex connections between various things in their environment. First trial, almost, it seems they learn these associations. Those birds that we captured, first trial learning. They hung on to that association between danger and that face. Very complex thing to learn, really. So if they can make those sorts of things so quickly, I don't think it's very difficult to associate food and perhaps the continuation of that feed by a particular person, and perhaps by leaving something they're more interested. They come out and look in the feeder and they leave something again, the person does. So it's out there, but I think it's in the realm of possibility of what these birds could do. And there are some precedents for it in nature. Other birds that give each other gifts for breeding or to attract others in, like bowerbirds. And dolphins have been known to give fish to other birds and humans as well in return, basically, for cooperatively fishing with them. So there's a variety of things that are suggestive that these sorts of associations are possible to make. And the more we know about, you know, how the brain of these animals really works, I think the more likely it is that this sort of thing could be going on. All right, so one more brain figure for you. The reason I say this is not only they make these associations, but they can refine them through time. So crows and other birds dream. We know that. We can play them songs in their as they sleep, and the parts of their brain that are activated when they learn that song are again activated. So that's, there's a learning loop that occurs in a bird and a mammal's brain that reptiles and amphibians don't have, and this allows them to reconsider their thoughts. So think of it this way. This information comes in maybe from sight or sound, goes into their forebrain, and it basically forms connections among nerve cells there. Okay, and those could be used to command a behavior, go down to your muscles and make you spring away or look this way or whatever it might be, drop a gift. But they can also go back to the forebrain. So when you're asleep, you're not moving around muscles and things and doing things. Those commands that would typically go to your muscles don't. They instead go back to your forebrain and you think about them, you dream about them, you reconsider them. You might shape them and modify them to act differently based upon your previous experiences. So when you get up in the morning after having slept on something, you've been thinking about it, you think more clearly about it often in the morning. That's a true phenomenon that happens with learning. And it's one of the functions of sleep is to sharpen those very strong associations that were made during the day, okay, so that you can rely upon them. Crows and other birds and mammals can do those same sorts of things. So they could be reconsidering the sorts of experiences they've had during a day and really holding on, literally forming strong connections between neurons of those that were the most important during the day that allowed them to escape or pointed out a person that would kill them next time they saw them. And they hang on to that. So I don't think it's out of line that they could be making those sorts of associations and thinking about them. So back to the main point here for you guys. A lot of times we get too much of nature. It passes what we call the cultural carrying capacity. Okay, you guys are at that carrying capacity right now with crows roosting in Bothell. Okay, they are at our carrying capacity and well above it for many of you, maybe not for others. So we view this differently, but basically we start seeing this as a problem. And when things become a problem or a challenge, the first thing we typically do is we want to get rid of it. And I'm glad that Bothell hasn't proposed shooting crows in the roost yet, because that's the common response around the world. It's done all over the place. They blow up roosts with dynamite. They cut down trees. They kill thousands of birds, millions of birds in the 40s and 50s in the Midwest were killed in roosts. So it's not an uncommon response to just get rid of the problem. But of course that doesn't solve the problem. Just puts it off, the birds increase again because they're increasing because of all the changes we've already done to our environment. We've made things perfect for crows here. A lot of food, shelter, we've reduced some predators. We've just made it a very great place for these birds to thrive. And now that's coming home to roost, literally, and it's becoming an issue for us. So my pitch is that what we know about the intelligence of these animals, the emotional responses they have to their environment, the way they learn and get around in their environment, is very similar to the ways that we do and other birds and mammals do. I think if they're being so considerate of where they are staying and how they're using the environment, we should be the same. We should think about very carefully why they're here, what they're doing, what are the disadvantages, advantages of it, and give them the same break, basically, by thinking carefully about what they're doing that they're giving us, thinking carefully about what we're doing and being able to live with us. There aren't a lot of animals that can live with us very well. These are ones that can. And I think the reason they are able to is because they see the world much like we do and respond to it much like we do. They try things and they learn quickly from what works and what doesn't work. And that allows them to survive with us. So just think carefully like they are about what we are doing here, okay, and how they are part of that interaction. And unfortunately, that doesn't happen very many places. I'm glad that it does here, but it doesn't very many places. So with that, I would thank you, and I'm glad to answer other specific questions about roosting or the birds here or anything else, or if those of you that need to leave, certainly can.